Wait. Okay, well, how's that sound? For those of you that don't know, this is the official Arizona Town Hall bell. It's been ringing in Arizona Town Hall sessions for over 50 years around the state of Arizona. And if you don't know me, my name is Tara Jackson, and I have the great honor of serving as president of the Arizona Town Hall, a role that I've served in for 9 years now. We'll get into what the town hall is about here in just a minute, but for all of you gathered here in Mesa and at the other 14 locations around the state, before we get started with the substance of what we're doing today, I want to let you know, first of all, thanks to all of our partners who are hosting these locations, whether it's community colleges, universities, government cities around the state. We all have a shared interest in helping you, we say future leaders, but many of you are leaders already. Leaders who in the future are going to have an even greater impact on our state. We want you to be educated and empowered to do the very best that you can, and that's why we work together to host these future leader town halls around the state. We also have help with some financial sponsors with which we couldn't do all the work that goes into coordinating these events. For the Future Leaders Town Hall on the topic of water, our sponsors include SRP, Cox Charities, and the Carstens Family Fund. So we thank them for also allowing us to put these together. I bet you all have cell phones, whether you're here or in San Luis or Flagstaff or Douglas, and we're actually going to tell you, take them out. Use what is your strength as our youth and our millennials, and let everyone know about the important discussion that you are engaging in, again, throughout the state. You are all connecting together through these incredible resources, and you can have an even greater impact on your generation by letting them know about the important discussions you have today. So there's some of our hashtags. We encourage you to take pictures and post them. We may even use them. And so, again, we encourage you to do that. And whether it's your cell phone or a fancy camera, there are some video contests that we know you all would be great at entering about water. We have two video contests associated with this particular topic, one that's through the Maricopa Community Colleges and another board member of the town hall who's sponsoring it for the rural areas. All of the details of that are on our website. For those of you at this location, and perhaps you have copies of it at the other locations, all of the information about that contest is there. I heard Alberto Olivas, who you'll meet in a few minutes, tell you that we don't get a lot of entries. So if you enter, your chances of winning are really good. So, you know, everyone enter. We want all of you to have an extra $100 in your pocket. And then there's a second contest for this particular town hall with the Arizona Water Association. They're giving out even more money to the grand prize winner. Not only that, they're going to give you a lot of attention. Are you looking for a good job where you can, you know, tout to all the Arizona leaders that you know how to get the word out about something? This would be the way to do it. The winners of this particular contest will be showcased at our big town hall in November. So that's another, just get out your cell phone, do some quick videos, put a little information about water. If you make it entertaining and humorous and short and you share it all over the place, all the better. So we hope that you will do that as well. So now let's get down to business for what we're doing here today. And I hope by now that NAU and Flagstaff are on the feed, as well as the 14 other locations around the state who will be discussing the exact same questions. All of you will be discussing the same questions, and you'll hear a little bit more from Alberto Olivas about that in a little bit. But first of all, real quickly, what is the Arizona Town Hall and why should you care about it? Other than the fact that we have a great bell that's been ringing in sessions for over 50 years, we are about educating, engaging Arizonans, and then empowering you to make a difference. That's what we do. We bring different political parties together. We bring different resources together. We're about solving the problem across political and professional lines. Historically, the Arizona Town Hall has tended to involve just those professionals who work full-time. We are trying to reach out to our youth and our future leaders because we think your voice is equally important. And so at our satellite locations around the state and even today, what you'll notice is that other than telling you what we're doing here today, I don't get an opinion. This is all for you to get your opinion to feed into the policy leaders. What you say here today absolutely will be heard and listened to and a part of the report that will go out to policy leaders around the state for years after this. So your work is very important, and we really care what you think. Now, you may not be an expert on water. You may not know much about water except that you turn on the faucet and you hope something comes out. And that's where I was about 10 years ago, before my first town hall on water. So before you get into these discussions, we want you to have at least a little bit of information from someone who is an expert on water, and that would not be me. So we have found someone for you who's going to give you just a little bit of an overview about Arizona water issues that hopefully will inform you on the discussions that you have. She has an incredible resume, which I won't read all of, but we will be sure is posted on our website, because I know that she would love to be a resource for you afterwards if you want to use her as a resource. So today I'll give her her very short title and introduce Kelly Mott-Lacroix, who's the Senior Research Analyst for the Water Resources Research Center down in Tucson. Please welcome Kelly.
Hi, you guys. It's really a great pleasure and honor to be able to speak to you here in this room and everyone remotely today. A couple of years ago, I was up in Cottonwood roaming what was literally acres of antiques, and I came across this little gem. It's an Arizona Highways magazine from 1961, and it's all about water. And one of my favorite things about this magazine is a series of poems, because when we work in water, a lot of times we think about hydrology and engineering and very hard stuff, not about poetry. And there's a poem in here about Roosevelt Dam. It's commemorating the 50th anniversary of the creation of that dam. And I'm going to read just a couple of lines to you, because I think it really sets up our whole conversation today and thinking about water. The dam. I am the dam. I was built of rock and stone and iron and cement and of men's faith and courage and dreams and hopes and visions. I was built to tame an unruly river. I'm not the biggest dam ever built, or the costliest, or perhaps not the most graceful. But I am the oldest. Other dams have been built on the river below me, and now we all work together to store water, make power, and offer all forms of recreation to city dwellers and the folks who live in this land that is thirsty no longer. A land that is thirsty no longer. That is where we live in Arizona. And in fact, the generations of Arizonans before us thought about and worked long and hard to ensure that our land was thirsty no longer. So much so that most of us don't even have to think about it. When was the last time you thought about where your water comes from? Or for that matter, where it goes? While it is true that water can neither be created nor destroyed, it just cycles through falling from the sky, pooling on the land, evaporating again, and then falling. It can be moved and it can be stored. Indeed, it is the act of moving and storing our water, which began with the building of Roosevelt Dam in 1911, that enables us to be here today and has made the land thirsty no longer. But where does your water come from today? If you're sitting with me here in the room or in another place here in Maricopa County, your water comes from the Gila, the Salt, the Verde rivers, from a 1,000-year-old groundwater beneath your feet, and even from Colorado River water, which is pumped uphill hundreds of miles to reach your tap with those little droplets that come out from many different places. If you're in Yuma, your water comes directly from the Colorado River, either diverted or pumped from shallow aquifers. If you're up in Flagstaff, you get your water from groundwater or from nearby Lake Mary. Down in Tucson, we get most of our water from the Colorado River as well, although by this point, it's traveled over 300 miles to reach us. That water goes back down into the ground and then is melded with groundwater and pumped again. But many areas outside of Tucson, the city of Tucson, and outside of our metropolitan areas rely just on groundwater. In each place, our water comes from rivers, also known as surface water, and groundwater. The mix of each varies. Some places depend almost completely on groundwater. Others depend almost completely on surface water. The state as a whole, we use about 57% of our water as surface water, about 40% is groundwater, and a small but very important 3% is reclaimed water, or water that was once surface water or groundwater, has been used, treated, and reused again, usually for landscaping, industrial, agricultural uses. Although we talk about different sources of water, groundwater and surface water, fundamentally they are all one and the same, all part of that cycle. Much of our groundwater discharges into streams eventually, or drops flowing in streams seep back into the groundwater. It is all connected. The land is thirsty no longer, but we are thirsty. We use about 7 million acre feet of water a year in Arizona. That's 2.3 trillion gallons a year. Another way to think about it is take Maricopa County and cover the entirety of Maricopa County with a foot deep of water. That's how much water we use in the state every single year. If you think about it on a more personal level, depending on where you live in the state, you use 60 gallons per day or to 300 gallons per day. If you take a water bottle, one of those water jugs, and you lay it down and you lay them end to end to end, if you use 60 gallons per day, that will stretch 2 miles. If you use 300 gallons per day, your water bottles would stretch over 10 miles, your personal water use. Most of the 7 million acre feet that we use, however, does not go to cities. 70% of the water used in the state of Arizona goes to agriculture, 25% of it to our cities, and the remaining 5% to industry, like mining and power generation. And while each of these uses takes from the ground or the surface water, they also each put water back in, but it's generally of a lower quality. It is this return flow, which is what we call it for agriculture, or reclaimed water, which is what we generally call it for cities and industry, that present a tremendous opportunity for getting the most out of every drop. And indeed, we have gotten the most out of every drop over the past 50 years. 9 years after this poem was written, in 1970, Arizona used 7.8 million acre feet of water per year, and we had a population of 1.8 million people. Recall that today we use 7 million acre feet, less than in 1970, yet we have a population of over 6.5 million people, and we grow more agriculture today than we did back in the 1970s. In particular, in Yuma, there's been a six-fold increase in vegetables over that period of time. We have, over our parents, and in some of your cases, grandparents' generations, become more efficient. We do more with less. But what will the future look like? Can we become even more water-wise? Although great progress has been made, we should remember that realizing the, quote, men's faith and courage and dreams and hopes and visions, man, that's a lot of ands, isn't it? Through maximizing our water, this can have consequences too. The poem speaks of taming our rivers. While a tamed river offers opportunities for storage and recreation on the lake, it also fundamentally changes an environment. Plants and animals supported by free-flowing rivers often cannot survive this change. But dams are not the only way that we impact our natural environment and the water within it. On a local scale, it's impacted by the many wells that we drill into the aquifers. On a regional to global scale, it's impacted by changes in our climate. Hotter days mean more evaporation, more intense rainstorms mean more flooding, and continued drought just means less water for everyone. Thinking about climate change, thirsty lands, trillions of gallons, miles of canals, and dams that dwarf even the tallest skyscraper here in Phoenix can be very intimidating. But contemplating your role in water and making a change around water does not have to be. In my work at the Water Resources Research Center at the University of Arizona, I had the privilege last year to interview people throughout the state about their thoughts and opinions on water, and in particular, their relationship with water in the environment. I heard many fascinating things during those interviews, but one that stuck with me in particular came from a member of one of Arizona's tribes. This person told me, "Water is a part of you, a life form. When we talk about water, you have to put the blood in it. Water is not just all around you in your life. It is a part of you. Each of you are about 60% water." So I have two challenges for you One will take a week, starting this afternoon, and the other, I hope, will take you a lifetime. In both, the goal is simple. I want each and every one of you to think about water. In the first, I challenge you to spend this afternoon coming up with as many great thoughts you can to answer these questions, and then wake up tomorrow morning and take every action you make and think about how water made it possible and how much water it uses. Wake up in the morning and turn on your light, if you're not sleeping in, of course. Chances are that electricity was made using water to either mine the coal or cool the power plant towers. Put on a t-shirt and jeans, and think of the water, and for that matter, the farmer, it took to grow that cotton. Walk to your kitchen and make some coffee, which is particularly important if you've slept in, right? And think about the water it took to grow those beans, to roast those beans, that happened long before you ever put your cup of water into that machine. Turn on the tap to wash your coffee cup, and think about where that water came from, and how fortunate you are that you don't have to walk for miles in order to have water to wash your coffee cup or your hair. In everything we do all day long, water plays some type of role. Just being aware of that role and talking about with other people who are here today with you, and perhaps most importantly, those who are not, creates awareness. Think of the impact if each of us shifted our personal water use from 10 miles of 1 gallon jugs to 2. In other words, the difference between 300 gallons per person per day to 60 gallons per person per day. My second challenge to you is to take a look at what you're most interested in as a career, whether it be a hydrologist, a doctor, a lawyer, a teacher, and incorporate a water consciousness into it. Some careers, like mine, or that of an engineer who works to build more efficient mechanisms of transporting water, have an obvious and direct connection to water. But you don't have to become a hydrologist, an engineer, or a water lawyer to impact Arizona's ability to keep our water glass full. What about if you're interested in becoming an architect? Could you design buildings that are more water efficient, or that capture and keep more water use on site so that you can water your plants with that water from the roof instead of pumping groundwater? What if you want to be an artist? Incorporate water and how you personally relate to it into your work. You'll further spread knowledge about its importance. Do you want to be a teacher, perhaps? Make sure your students read fiction that shows the impacts of droughts, or do science experiments on evaporation. Water can even be important to the aspiring philosopher. What about contemplating the question, what is so special about our relationship with these two molecules of hydrogen and one of oxygen? What if you want to be a businessman or woman? What new business could you create that capitalizes on our need for and concern about water efficiency? If you come from a farming family, what can you invent or implement that would allow you to grow more with less? Or perhaps even more importantly, what could you do to explain that vital role of water to the people who eat or wear your crops? If each of you listening today finds some way to incorporate water, a water consciousness, rather, into your chosen career, you, much like that dam built in 1911, will ensure that this land continues to be thirsty no more and remains an amazing place to live, work, and play for your generation, my generation, and the generations to come. Thank you.
Wow, what a wonderful foundation for a discussion on water, including so many great ideas that you can think of actions that you can take after today, not just actions that others can take. And that is, in fact, one of the goals that we strive for. So what exactly does happen now that you know a lot about water and what you might do with it? To tell you a little bit more about that, I want to introduce my partner in crime in many events, including first it was a youth town hall, now the future leaders town hall, but someone who shares a passion with me of civic engagement and creating leadership that really has an impact. So please welcome Alberto Olivas, who is the director of the Center for Civic Participation for Maricopa Community Colleges.
Thank you, Tara, and thanks to all of you. These future leader town halls are like Christmas for those of us involved in the town hall process. So I wanted to give you a little bit of context and tell you what to expect with this process. As a member of the town hall board, I've been involved with town hall for several years. And you may not know, Arizona town hall is a long-held tradition in our state, as Tara mentioned, going back over 50 years. And the Arizona town hall is a 2.5-3 day process by which state leaders, community leaders from all over Arizona come together and they talk in groups and work through their disagreements and differences with the goal of figuring out what is it that we can all live with as a state on whatever the topic is. And they're always really important and juicy and dramatic issues at stake for us in Arizona. So we have this long-held tradition of bringing people together to work through our differences and figure out what is our common ground and what do all of us, rural Arizona, urban Arizona, all of the different constituencies and generations, people that have just moved here recently and people whose families have been here for a long time, what do we all want for our future and what are we all willing to do to accomplish what we want for our state? So it's a complex process, and I think I can tell you that the future leaders version of this, the student version, comes out of the fact that we have a long-held tradition of bringing students to the Arizona Town Hall. So Maricopa Community Colleges, we always send students. Pima Community Colleges, the universities, all send students to sit at the table at the same level as legislators, as people from the governor's office, as county supervisors and city councilmen and mayors, and say, hey, this is what I think we should do in Arizona. No titles, no important positions. Everyone's at the same table, at the same level, with the same amount of consideration and respect. And because our students have done such a good job at representing their generation in these discussions, they pointed out to us, and the community leaders responded enthusiastically, the need to do more to surface the voice of young people and of students in our state. So because of that, we started several years ago having what we first called the student or the youth town hall, which we've now transitioned. We call it the future leaders town hall, which is what we're doing today, partly in recognition of the fact that we colleges and universities, our students are not just 18 to 25 year olds. Our students are coming to us from all stages in life and at all stages in their leadership trajectory. So many of you may be 18 and already have a lot of leadership experience. Some of you may be 60 and starting a second or third career, and you're just now thinking about getting into the waters of public policy and community leadership. We welcome you wherever you at, wherever you're at. And the Future Leaders Town Hall is happening today simultaneously in many locations to bring high school, college, and university students to learn from each other and to educate us and the other leaders that will participate in Arizona Town Hall about what is it that students have to say on this topic. So your role, I stress that to you, is very important. And the impact of what you discussed today will have untold echoes throughout the future. The history of Arizona Town Hall is one in which these community leaders would come together and decide recommendations, what we want to see happen. And those recommendations have had a lot of effect on our history. Recommendations from Arizona town halls have been used to create laws, to draft legislation that lawmakers decide. They've been used to create new programs, new community organizations and nonprofits. They've been used to affect what we teach in public schools. So there are many, many ways that the recommendations coming from Arizona town hall are implemented at the local and state level, and sometimes the federal level. What we do at Arizona town hall has been so effective that other states have looked at our model and are trying to figure out how they can do similar things. And now with the Future Leaders Town Hall, what we have is a very effective model for convening students across the state and coming out with a report that represents what students have to say about all of these issues, which is then presented to the participants in the Arizona Town Hall. So what you decide today, what you discuss today, will be presented for all of those big wigs that I mentioned to you before. They will consider that and they take it very seriously. So I hope you will take your role in this process very seriously as well. What's also unique about Arizona Town Hall is the model is based on one of deliberation and civil discourse as opposed to debate. So you're not going to see in this event or in the Arizona Town Hall events people standing up at podiums and arguing with each other and trying to prove why one or the other is wrong. The idea of deliberation is to figure out, despite our disagreements, what do we agree to? What are our common priorities, our common concerns? What can we all live with together? The point isn't to try and get anyone to change their mind or figure out that you're right and they're wrong, because that doesn't really happen. The point is for us to figure out, despite what we disagree with, what do we really need to work together to address the problems and the opportunities in our state. So in a couple minutes when we get you started in your group discussions, what's gonna happen is that your facilitators, your moderators, are going to lead you in a quick round of introductions, very quick, and then take you right away into a series of some pretty deep questions. So we ask you to pay attention, be thoughtful about the questions, and even if you're not sure about what you're saying, to participate to the extent that you can, and think about the communities that you represent, wherever you're from, however you define community, not necessarily geographically. Your job is to represent what you know, and to represent your future, and represent what you think needs to happen so that we're doing what we need to do to ensure a secure and prosperous future for our state and for you as and your family going well into the future. So each of your groups will have a moderator, a panel chair who will pose the questions to you and try and make sure that everyone has an opportunity to participate. And they are matched with a recorder, a note taker, who is not going to necessarily write something down every time somebody speaks. That recorder is just looking for those common ground consensus issues that come up. So they're going to be looking for you as a group to indicate when something is said that you all agree with. And you can really help by showing you agree physically, like, this may take a little bit of theater. Nod. Look happy when somebody says something that you like and you agree with. Use your whole body to show I'm on board with what has just been said. If not, if you don't agree with something that's been said, you need to do that as well. Shake your head. Furrow your brow. Look, make an ugly face. But it's important for the facilitator and the recorder to know, okay, we don't have agreement on this point. We need to do a little more discussion to figure out where is there a common ground on this issue. If you just sit there like a lump, then people will assume you're fine with what's just been said. So it's your job to really be courageous. Speak up, agree, disagree, but do so in a respectful way. That's the point of deliberation, is we don't attack people, we attack ideas. Ask questions to each other and say, you know what, I'm not sure I'm comfortable with what you've said, or I'm not sure I can live with that, or I don't agree, and here's why I don't agree, but please speak up. The moderators will be posing those questions, recorders will be writing it down, we'll begin in 1 minute, and we'll go until five, and then the tables will be giving reports out to show what did our table come up with that we agree needs to happen with this topic. You're looking for recommendations, and so it's important to keep that in mind. What you decide today will inform decisions made by community leaders in the future, but we're also looking for recommendations about what you can do individually and what you and your peers can do. So some things need to be handled at the state level, maybe federal level, but a lot of it can be handled by yourself. So what can you do differently than you're already doing? What influence can you have yourself on others around you? So we're looking for all of that good stuff. I'm excited for your conversations. And now we're going to go ahead and ask you to go to your table groups, and your facilitators will and your recorders will take you through this process. We're excited to hear what you're going to come out with, and thank you for participating in this important process for the future of our state.